Good morning. Welcome to Chalice Unitarian Universalist Congregation. We are a community of diverse beliefs and experiences, nurturing the liberal religious spirit and united in our desire to grow in love and in service. Whoever you are, whomever you love, whatever your life's journey, you are welcome here. Whether you gather with us every Sunday, once or twice a year, or are here this morning for the first time, we are glad you are here. I'm Maria Pia Duffy Foltz, the worship associate today. Our service is led by our minister, Reverend Sharon Wylie. Our worship musician this morning is Justin Gray, and our song leader is Lara Brown. Our tech team is Sarah Komnick, Hope Campbell, and Dean Gaudette. And our greeters this morning are Richard Quartz, Judy Cavallo, and Steve Schlesinger. Reverend Sharon and I have passed a rapid test this morning, so you will see us leading worship without our masks on. Welcome to our Sunday worship service. Welcome to those of you here in the chapel, and welcome to those of you watching live using Zoom. For those of us here in the chapel, you will notice that we have the windows open. This is to ensure good circulation in the room. There are also 4 air purifiers in the room for better air circulation. Please feel free to leave the chapel at any time if you are uncomfortable for any reason. You will be able to hear what is happening in the chapel while you are outside on the courtyard. For those of you using Zoom, please notice on your Zoom menu, there is a chat button. You are welcome to use the chat box during the service. Just please be sure that when you post that you've opened the little blue menu there to select everyone so everyone can see what's being shared. We are always delighted to see newcomers joining us in worship. As a newcomer, you might be interested in the groups and activities we offer. A good way to get this information is through our email, newsletter, and e-news calendar. For online newcomers, toward the end of the service, there'll be a link in the online chat box for adding your name to our email list. In-person newcomers, if you haven't already given us your email address when you signed in, please share it before you leave. Our weekly email is the best way to get information about the many groups and activities we offer here at Chalice. Now, let us take a breath together.
Good morning. According to the Library of Congress, the first permanent Euro-American settlements began a pattern of displacement and land appropriation of indigenous people that continued until the 20th century. In this region that we consider home, the Kumeyaay first lived here for over 10,000 years and were the people who greeted the Spanish when they first sailed into the San Diego Harbor in 1542. With this awareness, we acknowledge that Chalice is located on the stolen, tribal, ancestral homeland of the Apai, which is part of the Kumeyaay Nation, and the Payamkuichim Nation. This acknowledgement reminds us that we live in a history-driven present and that we need to be intentional with this land and with the people indigenous to the land. Mary Lyons from the Leech Lake Band of Ojibwe states, "When we, the indigenous people, talk about land, land is part of who we are. It is a mixture of our blood, our past, our current, and our future." According to the research done with Reclaiming Native Truth, 40% of Americans do not believe that indigenous people still exist in the U.S. Chalice hopes that with our first step of land acknowledgement, we can move towards educating ourselves and others about indigenous communities and their rich and diverse culture and create a meaningful relationship with them as well.
Now we light our chalice, the symbol of Unitarian Universalist faith. I'd like to invite Dwight Duncan forward to light our chalice this morning. Our chalice lighting words this morning come from Gady Gelfand, Director of Religious Exploration at the First UU Church of New Orleans. We light our chalice as a symbol of gratitude, as we celebrate the abundance of our lives together. In this sanctuary, we harvest bushels of strength for one another and offer our crop with the hands of compassion and generosity. In the authentic and gentle manner of our connections, we cultivate a simple sweetness to brighten our spirits. May we be grateful for the ways we nourish and uplift each other, for it is the sharing of this hallowed time together that sustains us.
The words of our call to worship this morning come from Reverend Tim Haley. Amid all the noise in our lives, we take this moment to sit in silence, to give thanks for another day, to give thanks for all those in our lives who have brought us warmth and love, to give thanks for the gift of life. We know we are on our pilgrimage here, but a brief moment in time. Let us open ourselves here now, the process of becoming more whole, of living fully, of giving and forgiving more freely, of understanding more completely the meaning of our lives here on this earth. Let us worship together. You're invited to rise in body or spirit to join in singing.
Sunday worship is the shared spiritual practice of our community, and we tend to the congregation during this time by sharing and honoring our joys and sorrows. Here in the chapel, you are welcome to write your joy or sorrow onto a candle card, which will be collected from you. I'll be coming around to collect them. Online, please write your joy or sorrow, including your name, into the chat box. These joys and sorrows will be spoken out loud, and then we will remove them from this part of the service, from the recording that goes onto our YouTube channel. So this sharing won't be publicly available online. So we have a few minutes of music so you can write down what you would like to share. If you would like to send Reverend Sharon a confidential note about your joy or sorrow, or to make a prayer request, please email her. Her email address will be on the screen in a moment.
Mm-hmm.
This morning, we begin by lighting a candle of sorrow in recognition that today is Transgender Day of Remembrance, marking the numerous transgender lives that have been lost to violence this year so far. We have lost at least 32 transgender or gender nonconforming lives to violence this year in the United States. Those are the ones that we know of. It's not always clear when someone has died. Let's remember that Black and Latinx transgender people face disproportionate violence, and may we all join in the struggle to eliminate harassment, discrimination, and violence against transgender people. And we'll light our second candle for sorrow about the shooting last night in Colorado Springs at an LGBTQ nightclub. 5 people died. I know we all pray for the day that people can live their lives without being attacked for who they are. And then we have many joys to share this morning. And we light a final candle this morning, our pillar candle, for all the joys and sorrows in the room that go unshared and unspoken.
Thank you, Amu, by Oge Mora. The author would like you to know that Amu is the Igbo term for queen, but when she was growing up, it meant grandma. On the corner of First Street and Long Street, on the very top floor, Amu was cooking a thick red stew in a big fat pot for a nice evening meal. She seasoned and stirred it and took a small taste. "What a delicious stew," Amu said. "Tonight's dinner will surely be the best I have ever had." With that, Amu put down her spoon and went to read a book before supper. As the thick red stew simmered on the stove, its scrumptious scent wafted out the window and out the door, down the hall, toward the street, and around the block, until, knock, someone was at the door. When Amu opened it, she saw a little boy. "Little boy," Amu exclaimed, "what brings you to my home?" "I was playing with my race car down the hall when I smelled this most delicious smell," the little boy replied. "What is it?" "Thick red stew." "Mmm, stew," he sighed. "That sure sounds yummy." Amu thought for a moment. She was saving her stew for dinner, but she had made quite a bit. It would not hurt to share. "Would you like some?" The little boy nodded, and so Amu spooned out some thick red stew from the big fat pot for her nice evening meal. "Thank you, Amu," the little boy said, and went on his way. With that, Amu closed the door and went back to her book. As she read, her thick red stew's scrumptious scent wafted out the window and out the door, down the hall, toward the street, and around the block until, knock, knock, someone was at the door. When Amu opened the door, this time she saw a police officer. "Ms. Police Officer," Amu exclaimed, "what brings you to my home?" I was on duty down the street when I smelled the most delicious smell, Ms. Police Officer replied. What is it? Thick red stew. Oh, stew, she said, and her mouth watered. That sounds mighty tasty. Amu thought for a moment. There was still enough to share. Would you like some? The police officer nodded. Once again, Amu spooned out some thick red stew from the big fat pot for her nice evening meal. Thank you, Amu, the officer said and went on her way. For the second time, Amu closed the door and went back to her book. Sure enough, as she read, her thick red stew's scrumptious scent wafted out the window and out the door, down the hall, toward the street, and around the block, until, knock, knock, knock. Again, someone was at Amu's door. This time when she opened it, she saw a hot dog vendor. Mr. Hot Dog Vendor, Amu exclaimed, what brings you to my home? I was selling my hot dogs down the block when I smelled the most delicious smell, Mr. Hot Dog Vendor replied. What is it? Thick red stew. Oh, stew. The vendor licked his lips. That sounds quite delectable. So Amu spooned out some thick red stew from the big fat pot for her nice evening meal. Thank you, Amu, the hot dog vendor said, and went on his way. Throughout the day, people from all across the neighborhood knocked on Amu's door. She fed a shop owner, a cab driver, a doctor, an actor, a lawyer, a dancer, a baker, an artist, a singer, an athlete, a bus driver, a construction worker. Even the mayor stopped by. And each time they knocked, Amu shared. Soon the sky darkened, the street lights brightened, and it was finally time for dinner. But when Amu opened her big fat pot of thick red stew for her nice evening meal, it was empty. Amu sniffed. There goes the best dinner I ever had. Sorry and blue, she sat at the table with her empty pot. Until, knock, 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 knock. Who could that be? Amu wondered. When she opened her door, she saw the little boy, the police officer, the hot dog vendor, the shop owner, the cab driver, the doctor, the actor, the lawyer, the dancer, the baker. Why, everyone she fed today was at her door. I'm sorry, everyone, Amu sighed. My thick red stew is all gone. I have nothing left to share. The little boy tugged at Amu's sleeve. Don't worry, Amu. We are not here to ask. We are here to give. The police officer carried in a fresh salad. The mayor entered with a roast chicken. The baker brought a collection of sweet goodies. Even the little boy presented Amu with something special in a shiny red envelope. Everyone who had knocked on Amu's door that day squeezed inside her tiny apartment, and together they ate, danced, and celebrated. While Amu's big fat pot of thick red stew was empty, her heart was full of happiness and love. That dinner was the best she ever had.
So in our Unitarian Universalist faith tradition, we are covenanted to affirm and promote eight principles. without looking at the internet. First, this is just a basic question. Do you think you know what they are? Raise your hand. You won't have to try and do it. Nobody here thinks they could do the eight, like not word for word. The Laura claims that the teenagers could. I appreciate your self-awareness. Do we think we know some of them? You don't have to know. Which, so, tell me. Interdependent web of all existence. Inherent worth and dignity of every person. Here, I'll read them. The wondering why, so folks can't hear, belief in the democratic process. It's close. Okay, we said the inherent worth and dignity of every person, 1. 7, respect for the interdependent web of all existence of which we are a part. I'll give you the right of conscience and the use of the democratic process within our congregations and in society at large. That's how we remember them though, right? One about democracy. Okay, so what else? The free and responsible search for truth and meaning. The eighth principle, journeying towards spiritual wholeness by working to build a diverse, multicultural, beloved community by our actions that accountably dismantle racism and other oppressions in ourselves and institutions. We studied that one a lot last year. We're at 5.
Okay, there's one about taking from different traditions.
You're thinking of the sources. So there are 6 sources of our faith tradition that we also often look at the same time as the principles. So, but it's not a principle by itself. I know, it's okay, you're in the ballpark. So we're still at 5. This is a really good exercise.
Interconnected web.
We did that one. We did interconnected web. There are 2 of them that say justice. That we did that one, that was 7. Okay, I invite you to recall that a room full of Unitarian Universalists, some of you lifelong, could remember 5 and knew there was something about justice. You wanna give it a go? You're trying to name all the what? I can't hear. Oh, all the dwarves. Different sermon. That'll be a different sermon. All right, so I think that's really instructive. And to be honest, I am a minister of the Unitarian Universalist faith tradition, and I am not entirely confident I could get them all either. Keep that in mind this year, because we're gonna be talking about changing them. And when we talk about it, people tend to think, but I love them. So just remember how many of them you know. So in addition to these 8 principles, there are 6 sources that our faith tradition draws from. And these principles and sources are defined in the bylaws of the Unitarian Universalist Association, which we abbreviate the UUA. So you bear with me while we talk about those bylaws for a minute, because that's where these things are. So in 2017, the Board of Trustees of the UUA formed a study commission, which is called the Article 2 Study Commission. Do you remember this from last year, boys and girls? The principles and sources are found in Article 2 of the UUA bylaws. And so the study commission is to review Article 2 and to propose revisions. And this was the charge that the board gave them. This is the language. To propose revisions that will enable our UUA, our member congregations like ours, and our covenanted communities to be a relevant and powerful force for spiritual and moral growth, healing, and justice. So, and we do this regularly. It's in our bylaws that we should call for review of our principles and sources on a semi-regular basis. So it's not unusual that they call the commission to do this. So that commission has been doing its work, and a draft of the proposed changes has recently been made public for public feedback. So the commission has been accepting feedback on their proposed changes, and they will be making further revisions based on that feedback. So I think they're done having Zoom meetings. I'm not sure if they're still taking feedback through an online form. So if you're interested in that, let me know. But my sense is we should get on it quickly because they're just about done taking feedback on this phase. Then the commission will finalize its proposed changes. So they're going to be making some revisions, I would guess, to the principles and sources early next year. And I think their goal is that in January, that they will publish their proposed changes, which will then be considered at the 2023 General Assembly of the UUA, which happens in June. So making a change to Article 2 of the bylaws is a 2-year process. So changes will be voted on in 2023 and then again in 2024. And there's the year in between is undoubtedly considered a year of study. So it is the nature of our evolving faith tradition that we periodically consider changing our principles and sources. It's simultaneously a very big deal, but also know that it's routine. We don't change them that often, but we consider changing them pretty regularly. We're not a faith tradition that points to any text ever, anywhere, and says, these can never change. That's not who we are. So I know that like bylaw and study commission stuff is a lot to take in, but all of that is to help orient us to what we call our spirit study topic for the year, a series of sermons, I give one a month, which is looking at these proposed changes. So this first draft proposes that we share, the 7-8 principles are gone. This first draft proposes that we share 6 values: pluralism, interdependence, equity, evolution, justice, generosity, and a 7th value, love, is the enduring force at the center. It's depicted, those 6 values in a circle with love at the center as the enduring force that holds us together. Our congregation's mission statement, which we adopted this past June, begins with words affirming that love is at our center. And I felt that spark of recognition when I saw similar words from the study commission. So today I want to talk about our shared value of generosity. Here are the draft words from the study commission. I like them and I both feel like, well, but don't get too attached. We don't know what will be changing, but I love this first go at it. We cultivate a spirit of gratitude and hope. We covenant to freely share our faith, presence, and resources. Compassionate generosity connects us one to another in relationships of mutuality. What I appreciate about these words is that they speak to more than just financial generosity, which was what we often think of when we think of being generous. Those words again. We cultivate a spirit of gratitude and hope. We covenant to freely share our faith, presence, and resources. Compassionate generosity connects us one to another in relationships of mutuality. I think the connection between gratitude and hope is that when we are mindful of all that we have been given, all that is good in the world, then we reconnect with our hope that change is possible, that goodness is abundant, that love will overcome fear. We are generous with ourselves when we are in touch with our gratitude for all that is good. And our gratitude for all that is good connects us with our hopes for a better and more beautiful future. I am thinking of generosity today because today, the Sunday before Thanksgiving, is our annual celebration of our founding members. We have often told the stone soup story this day, the story of villagers all contributing an ingredient to make a soup that feeds them all. And that got us started on actually making soup to have together this day when we were hearing about the delicious scent of Amu's stew, I was thinking how good it smelled standing outside the kitchen before the service. I am grateful for our volunteers who raised a hand to make chalice soup possible again this day. Religious communities like ours are these incredibly rare communities that run on the enormous commitment and dedication of our congregants. People who got here early today to help set up the courtyard, people cooking soup in the kitchen right now, our greeters, our worship associates, our song leaders, coffee team, refreshments team, our congregants who are putting the technology together for us. All this is just today, this morning. All week long, we have groups and activities. I was here on Wednesday to meet with a congregant, and there were people in the hub and someone working away in the chapel, and it felt hustly-bustly here, like before the pandemic. Every day of the week, day in and day out, this congregation and this campus exists because a couple of hundred people come together and say, we want this community to exist. And we're willing to put in time and money to make it happen and to keep it going. To me, it's an ordinary miracle. And we don't think about it that much, except once in a while on days like today. Our story this morning is a different kind of soup story than the traditional stone soup's tale. The story of Amu's generosity with her neighbors and their generosity to her in return is a story of people leaning on each other and giving when they can and how they can. The neighbors don't try to make a thick red stew to give back to Amu. Instead, they bring their own gifts, what they're good at making. Religious community is very much like that. We can't all give the same thing, but if each of us can share our gifts, we hopefully have among us what the community needs to survive and to thrive. This is the essence of financial generosity as well. The religions of the world understand generosity as a spiritual practice. It's not about giving more than anyone else. It's about giving what you can, whatever that is. In Buddhism, generosity is the first perfection on the path to enlightenment. In Islam, one of the five pillars is the practice of charitable giving. In Judaism, giving to the poor is understood as an obligation, an act of justice and righteousness, not charity. In Christian tradition, Jesus taught that it is better to give than to receive. And pagan tradition holds that whatever you give away returns to you three times over. I say, when we open our hands to give generously, our hands are then open to receive in return. When we open our hearts to give generously, our hearts are then open to receive in return. When we open our spirits to give generously, then our spirits are open to receive in return. A little bit later in the service, we'll see the names and faces of the 27 founding members who are still with us and involved at Chalice. Here is a short story version of our beginnings. This congregation was founded in 1984 as the Unitarian Universalist Inland North County Fellowship. In 1989, a group split from UUINCF to form Chalice Church. And for 11 years, there were two UU congregations in the Poway, Rancho Bernardo areas. Eventually, happily and thankfully, the two congregations reunited. And on January 1st, 2000, Chalice Unitarian Universalist Congregation was formed. This is why you'll sometimes hear, even though this congregation is 23 years old, you'll hear people say they've been here for 30 years. That's why you hear those different numbers. So now our 23rd year as Chalice UU congregation is coming to a close, and January 1st will begin our 24th year. and I am in my 11th year as your called and settled minister. I am blessed to be a part of the ordinary miracle that is our community, and I hope you too feel yourself blessed to be here. You're invited to rise in body or spirit to sing together. Sunday offering is an expression of the generosity that makes our congregational life possible. Today is our monthly Social Justice Sunday, when we donate our offering to support taking action in the service of promoting UU principles in the wider world. This month, our offering supports Chalice's UU the Vote efforts. These past few months, Chalice congregants wrote over 13,000 letters to get out the vote for the 2022 midterm elections. Wonderful Woo! Job. Thank you to everyone who participated. All those stamps and postage costs cost a significant amount of money, and Chalice contributed a portion. So today's offering will be used to replenish Chalice coffers. Please text your donation to Chalice. If you haven't texted a donation before, know that once you text the amount, you'll get a reply with a link to follow to enter your credit card information. If you have already entered this information previously when you've donated, you won't need to enter it again. If your Sunday donation is meant to be part of your pledge payment, please be sure to indicate pledge after the dollar amount. The phone number for text donations will be on a screen in a moment. Now, if you'd like to do things the old-fashioned way, we have a basket and envelopes on the table by the door in which you can place your check. Please give generously. Thank you.
Please join in dedicating our offering with words of affirmation.
At Chalice UU Congregation, our mission is to connect through the worship, music, learning, and caring in ministries.
Breath. celebrate life's interval. Thanks be for these ennobling art images, welcome to our sight, music caressing ear and heart, inviting us to laughter height. Thanks be for these who question why, who noble motives do obey, those who know how to live and die, comrades who share this holy way. Thanks be for these we celebrate, sing and rejoice our trust in.
Please rise or remain seated as you wish and sing hymn number 126.
Before we close this service, I'd like to remind newcomers online to please use the link in the chat box to add your name to our email list. Our closing words come from Reverend Brian Kiley. The chalice is now extinguished, but it lights lives on the minds and hearts and souls of each one of you. Carry that flame with you as you leave this place and share it with those you know, with those you love, and most especially with those you have yet to meet. Love and blessings to each of you. Blessed be. You are invited to close our time together by singing the well. After our closing hymn, please return to your seats for an announcement and a brief yet special presentation.
quenches my thirst, a thirst for justice, a thirst for joy, a thirst for a love that we're all a part of. We drink from the well. We drink from the well together. Hand in hand we are standing as one, standing for justice, standing for joy.
It's almost December, so it's almost December 3rd, which is the date of our winter party from 5 to 7 out on the patio. It's going to be a potluck. There should have been an email that went out last week with a sign up, so you can RSVP and volunteer to help out bringing a dish. And and we'll probably have that going out in the e-news in the coming weeks. Also, there's going to be some amazing entertainment brought to you by the Chancel Choir and various well-known and loved Chalice musicians, so you're not going to want to miss that. And everything is going to be outside on the patio this year. That will provide safe communal eating and enjoyment. Also, this is a winter party, so it might get below 70 degrees. So for some of you, that might mean flip-flops and a t-shirt, but for others of us, we might need to bundle up. We will have some heaters, but please dress so that you'll be comfortable. And I want to also especially invite our families and our youth and children to come out. I'm probably going to need some helpers throughout the evening, and I would like you guys to be a part of it. Okay, thanks.
So this is the next installment of the Powering into the Future campaign, where we submitted grant requests for a number of different proposals. Last week we talked about the solar. This week we're going to talk about some of the things that we proposed for tech. Go ahead and put up the first slide, or put up the slide. Okay, go to the next one. First, we're going to learn something new today. That's a UPC code. Okay, for those of you who aren't familiar with it, we've been trying to use those more, but so today's also the last day you can order bread and cinnamon rolls for Thanksgiving. So if you would, if you haven't done this before, just get out your cell phone. You won't order anything, don't worry. Well, I would like you to, but you don't have to. But it's also an experiment. I want to see that this actually works. So if some of you can get out your cell phones, if you've never done this before, reading these codes is really easy. You just get your cell phone out and turn on your camera, like you're gonna take a picture. You may have to zoom in, but what you should see, and I probably can't do it from here, but you just zoom in on that and you should see like a little link pop up on your camera. And then you click on that and it'll take you to a form to order bread. So, so we're trying to do this more also for mainly for people online, but the idea is that you know, the connection card, an order of service, and in this case, this is a form to order bread, things like that, of having that available. So I hope you learned something new. And then order bread and cinnamon rolls as needed, because today is the last day. And the proceeds go to Chalice and to this campaign, to the Powering Into the Future campaign. So you get double your money. Yes, the bread is homemade. The cinnamon rolls you've all hopefully had some experience with. Is everybody got it? Or is this good enough? Okay, so go ahead to the next slide. So the tech committee is myself, Sharon, David O'Gwynn, and I added Hope to it without telling her. But Hope has been a great addition and she's been so helpful. I can't say enough about it. Okay, so, next slide. In about a year ago, or maybe not a year ago, so we had an opportunity, the spirit level had various topics that they wanted people to submit grants for, and we put one together for solar and we did one for tech. And this is gonna talk a little bit about the tech stuff. So, but the purpose of this and why we have tech is one is to create compelling online services. When we started the pandemic, Sharon was doing them basically, you know, by herself. And actually they were very compelling. They were very close up. It was very personal. And in going to the chapel, you know, having one camera in the back with a wide angle view just doesn't cut it anymore. So we also want to provide for better in-person services. So there's a couple of things that have to do that with that I'll touch on. And then there's tech for the hub in terms of one of the goals is to help Chalice become a center for liberal religious thought in Escondido. And we're gonna just touch on this. It'll be kind of fast because I don't want to keep you here too long. But I'm, because there's soup. Okay, so we've been learning as we go. What we found is that people online really like to see and hear the people who are in person. And so that's one thing that we don't actually do very well right now. So that's part of the grant is to have more microphones so that they can hear when you clap and they can hear when you laugh and they can hear and they can participate that. And it turns out to be really important to the people online. Speaking of which, could you monitor the online chat for if any questions? People like close-ups, not long shots. Things like remounting the cameras. You guys may not notice this, but if you're sitting next to a camera and you bump the wall or something like that, it's like a little earthquake. For the most part, it doesn't happen. It happens sometimes, but it's like, we really would like them to be up a little bit higher and a little more. And then the ability to make more on the fly adjustments. So this is just a schematic of the chapel, talking about maybe adding a camera, adding a microphone, adding another camera. But also the purple stuff is potentially adding some storage in the back. So it's not just this big pile of stuff behind the tech table, which is what it is now. Just go ahead to the next slide. All right, this is TMI. But the bottom line is what you're probably not aware of is this is a lot more complicated than doing, you know, from Sharon's office. And for example, up here in the upper corner there, in the upper, that's gonna be your right, the Chalice speaker, the chapel speakers in here, there's an assisted listening system. There are outdoor speakers in the patio, there's outdoor speakers in the back. And then the inputs to that, so the Chalice microphones, everything comes into the soundboard and it goes out to like four different and independent sound feeds. And so all of that has to get handled. It gets sent to OBS and then gets sent out to Zoom. So on the video side, we're looking at maybe adding some more cameras so we can get close-ups of Justin while he's playing, you know, the piano and things like that. So go ahead, next slide. Okay, so the hub, when we did the construction, we ran an underground channel basically for the network over to the hub and got that all wired up. But next slide. So we have one owl. What we want to do is we proposed adding one or two more of these you know, want to get from feedback from people who have used this to see if that's the best way to go. They're pretty easy to use and feedback's been pretty good. I don't know if you've used them at all. But if you go over to the Blue Room, you can go check it out. We have one set up there. And not going to get into it too much. It's a very simple way and a little more compelling than just having, again, a big shot of the room. It's kind of got an AI in it that lets you lets it focus on the people who are talking. So we want to, no, that's okay, next slide. We also want to add one in the Rainbow Room and maybe in the other rooms, because you can mount them upside down, because like if you want to have an online yoga class or karate class, which is actually, we've talked to somebody about renting for that, it can kind of operate on the whole room. Okay, next slide. This is the setup for the Blue Room. And basically we're talking about duplicating that a couple of times. And that is what is also part of the grant. What's the next slide? I've forgotten. Oh, okay, questions, there you go. Anybody have any questions? I know there's, I covered, zoomed through that pretty quickly, no pun intended. Oh, go ahead, Patty, sorry.
If we do have a yoga class in the Rainbow Room, will the instructor be able to manage that whole system?
So the question is, if we have a yoga class in the Rainbow Room with this setup, will the instructor be able to manage all that? Yeah, the idea is to make it easy. I think the idea, though, is once you get it turned on, it's kind of just, you would just run. It wouldn't, I mean, for a yoga class. But yes, that's the idea.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know the details. We're getting pretty close. So that's why you should buy bread, because all of that goes to it. I think we are pretty close to meeting our goal, and hopefully in the next week or two, we'll reach that. Anything else? Yes, Victoria.
I'm relaying a request from some online congregants who would like to see more of us.
Right.
In the Blue Room, or the thought was maybe we could set something up on the patio at some point.
Okay, so Victoria was relaying something from people online saying that, and I've heard that as well, that people like to see the people here, and we need to find better ways to do that. You know, we have a way to swing that camera around so you can see everybody, that kind of thing. But they also want to interact. Okay, so, all right, good. Yeah, that's something that we'll be looking at. Are there any questions online? Okay. All right, thank you. And order bread.
Okay, so hold on, still. For those of you who have joined us online this morning, please remember that coffee hour is now in the same Zoom room as the service. So if you'd like to chat with people, just stay tuned. Don't exit the Zoom meeting. There'll be a brief break and some music for about 5 minutes. Then the Zoom meeting will be opened and people can chat with each other online. So just stay tuned. Don't exit, just stay there and you'll be in the coffee hour. For our in-person congregants, you're invited to enjoy social hour and the wonderful soup that we've been smelling for the past hour and a half. In the spirit of caring, to follow up on what Victoria said, you might want to take your refreshment into the Blue Room so you could visit with our online congregants, because some of them haven't been able to attend chapel for a while. And obviously they really would like to see some of us. And a final reminder, as usual, remember that children younger than 5 may not be fully vaccinated, so take care around them. Everything is waiting for you outside in the courtyard. Please enjoy.